Hello and welcome back to the second part of our A-star pathfinding series. Before we dive in into the today's tutorial, I want to show you why, despite Unreal Engine's powerful built-in navigation system, it may not be the best fit for our specific needs. I have set up a 7x13 grid system, and to demonstrate, let's add a new nav mesh bound volume to the level. I'll position it in the center. And to cover the entire grid, we need to set its size to 1300 by 700. Press the P key on your keyboard and wait a moment to visualize the nav mesh. Now, if I add a static mesh to the level, you'll notice that some areas are no longer green. Let's see if we can make the mesh small enough to fit within a single tile. As you can see, the nav mesh doesn't perfectly align with the tile. Even if I go into the recast nav mesh and adjust the agent radius, we still don't have full control. And you'll notice it's also rotated. But that's not our only issue. If you try to get a random location on a tile to check if it's walkable using the random location in navigable radius function, oops, looks like the wrong actor is selected. Let me quickly replace that with a tile. The problem arises when you decrease the radius, as it often returns invalid locations. If you increase the radius, it extends beyond the tile area, but we need precision here. After extensive testing, I have concluded that while Unreal Engine's navigation system is powerful, it just isn't designed for our specific use case. Let's create our own custom solution that's simple yet powerful for grids. I'll start by creating a new function called isWalkable. Its purpose is straightforward. It will return whether a tile is walkable or not. For the input, I'll specify the grid type, since our approach differs between the square and hexagon tiles. To keep things efficient, this function will be pure and const. I'll also clean up our functions by organizing them into their respective categories. Next, I'll add a switch on the input of this function and connect each of its nodes to the output nodes. Now it's time to create custom functions for the different grid types. First, I'll create a trace on box function, which will be pure and const, and I'll categorize it under the trace. I want to make this function generic so it can be reused for other purposes. For outputs, we'll have a boolean to check if anything is detected, and a hit result for more detailed information. Next up is the trace on hexagon function, also categorized under trace. It will be pure and const as well. I'll include an input to determine whether the tile is point-up hexagon or not. The outputs will be the same as before, a boolean and the hit result. Now let's integrate this function into the isWalkable function. We can't connect the trace result directly to the output, though I need to reverse the result, because if the trace finds something, it returns true, meaning the tile is walkable. But if something is in a tile, that tile is not walkable. I'll also add the hexagon trace function, ensuring the input is set correctly. Let's complete the trace on box function using box trace, which can be set up either by channel or by object. depending on what works best for your project. I'll also create a new function to calculate the trace start location, so we can reuse it in other trace function. Naturally, this function will be pure, const, and categorized under trace. The output will be a simple vector that we'll add to the trace function. For the trace end, we can just use the tile location. In the past, I've encountered bugs where I had to manually add the trace owner to the ignore list to ensure it's ignored by the trace. Basically, doing what the ignore self node is supposed to handle, but the bug is fixed and you don't have to do that. Let me double check everything. Oops, I need to make sure this is connected to the end node. Next, let's determine the bug's half size. For now, I'll use the mesh box extent, but we'll need to adjust it slightly after running some tests. Before I forget, let's figure out the start trace location. I want to start the trace from above the tile, and since my tiles don't have any rotation, I can simply add an offset to the tile location. If your tiles do have rotation, you'll need to multiply the offset by the actor's up vector and then add it to the actor location. I'll enable the draw debug feature so we can see the trace boxes. I want them to be persistent since this function only gets called once. Now back to the generator. At the begin play event, I add the tiles node to the graph and call a foreach loop on it. We can now call the isWalkable function on each tile. Let me delete the branch node and just use the printString node to display the results. Lastly, I'll connect the grid type. I'll use the simulate function so I can freely rotate around and check things out. As you can see, each tile has its own trace, but none of them are walkable. That's because the tiles are very close together, causing the trace to hit the neighboring tile. Also, the tracing step is pretty small, so we'll need to adjust that too. Back to the trace function. First, I'll add a small value to increase the tracing step. Then, I will multiply it by a scalar value to shrink the entire box size, decreasing it by about 10%. Before testing, let's head back to the level. I will disable the visibility channel for the background mesh, and then we'll test it again. I'll use the simulate function once more, and as you can see, this time all the tiles return true. They are walkable. The increased tracing step worked perfectly, and you can clearly see each trace. If I zoom in, you'll notice the trace box perfectly matches the tile size, with no overlap between neighboring tiles. Now, let's move on to creating the trace for the hexagon tiles. For this, I'll use the capsule trace function. We already have a function to calculate the start location, and the end location will be the same as the tile location. For the radius, I'll use the box extent again, but we'll need to adjust it depending on whether the hexagon is point top or flat top. I'll also need to multiply the final radius by 0.9 to reduce the capsule size by 10%. To select the correct axis, I can use the select node. If it's a point up hexagon, I use the X axis. Otherwise, I use the Y axis. This ensures tracing only within the inner circle of the hexagon. Next, we'll set the capsule half height. This time, I won't add the tile to the ignore list, as the ignore self node should handle that. We need to change the grid type and reinitialize it, so we can see the hexagon tiles in action. As you can see, all the tiles are walkable. If I zoom in, you'll notice the trace is confined to the inner circle of each tile. We could potentially increase the size by 2 or 3%, but I think keeping the 10% reduction works well for now. Let me quickly disable the debug mode on both functions, since we don't need to check them at the begin play events anymore. I can also organize these functions into their proper categories. Now that we have successfully implemented a custom navigation solution in Unreal Engine, there is just one more step before we can implement the AAStar algorithm. In the next video, I'll show you how to efficiently get the neighbors of a tile, ensuring it works seamlessly for large grids without causing any performance issues. Thank you for watching.